humble. I'd like to say I'm speechless, but it's hard to catch me speechless. Now that goes. I may be a little more speechless tonight than I was this morning. I ate so much food today, I'm not sure how long that I'm going to be able to stand before you have to roll me down. I want to thank you so much. The lasagna, the peach cobbler, it was a wonderful afternoon. I have been blessed both with spiritual as well as physical food today, more than I certainly deserve, and so I am grateful. This morning, we began a series on the eternal and essential nature of the Lord's one New Testament church, and I urge you, if you're here tonight and you weren't here this morning, to get some of those handouts. We're out, by the way, Landon. We need more of those. And the other one that was supposed to be available after tonight isn't ready. I can bring some with me. We'll have a different one ready for tomorrow night as well. But these all build on one another, so even though I don't want to use a lot of time, I want to bring you up to speed fairly quickly, if I may. This morning in our Bible class, we talked about the eternal and essential nature of the Lord's one New Testament church as the prophesied Old Testament kingdom. And we went back and we looked at several Old Testament texts that showed us that this kingdom that God would establish would be established during the days of the Roman Empire. It would be established and would never be destroyed or left to another people. We talked about how it would originate in Jerusalem, and we talked about those prophecies. And then this morning in the worship service sermon, we talked about the eternal and essential nature of the Lord's one New Testament church as the promised New Testament kingdom. And we looked at many texts, and again, I understand it was recorded. Please get a copy of that if you weren't able to be here this morning or if you want to look at those again. We spoke about many different texts that prove that the kingdom did indeed come in the first century. In fact, we can point to the day, because during the reign of the Roman Empire, in Acts chapter 2 in 33 AD, the Lord's church came, and the Lord had spoken over and over in the Gospels about the church and called it the kingdom in Matthew chapter 16. And he talked about how it would come during some of the then disciples' lifetime. And he talked about how this kingdom would be opened up by Peter. Peter would have the keys to the kingdom, the church. And we saw in Acts 2 that Peter indeed opened up the church, which is the kingdom. We showed how every text prior to Acts 2 shows the coming kingdom as something future, and how the texts after Acts 2 look back to the kingdom as something already having been established, how the Colossians were in it, and Paul was in it, and John was in it, and so many others. Yes, it is provable based on that outline and those lessons and those texts that the Lord's kingdom came in the first century. Yet despite that absolute black and white, undeniable proof from the unchangeable word of God regarding the fact that his kingdom did indeed come in the first century, his church over which he is king and head, despite all of that, there are those both outside the church as well as sadly within the Lord's church whom, as Jesus said in Matthew 22 verse 29, are mistaken because they don't know the scriptures or the power of God, who still claim, aggressively and militantly claim and advocate against this very unique, exclusive, spiritual kingdom as having come, this church of Christ, this kingdom of God. I want to paint for you three scenarios tonight of those who claim that it has not come despite all that the scripture says, in fact, that it has. I'm going to ask you to open your Bibles tonight to the third chapter of the book of Ephesians, and again, as I said this morning, please open your Bibles and check all these texts out. Do not take my word for anything. As gracious as the brethren have been in this congregation to say wonderful things about me, as Paul said to Cornelius, hey, I'm just a man. I make mistakes. God doesn't. Please open your Bibles and check it out. I want to paint for you three scenarios of those who claim that the kingdom has not yet been established as God said he established it. Number one, there are those denominations out there who not only deny that the church and the kingdom are one and the same, but they claim that despite all the Bible says about this kingdom and how it did indeed come, they claim that the church was just what we call a stopgap measure. That's a word you use down here in the South, right? Stopgap. You got to remember, I'm from Maine. The church was just a stopgap measure. There are probably even some of those denominations in this town who teach that when Christ came, he came to set up this kingdom, this marvelous, wonderful kingdom, but that somehow the Roman authorities and the Jews got to him before he could accomplish setting up that kingdom he came to establish. And so he just put the church in place as kind of a stopgap measure until he comes to finish what he started when he was here the first time. How many of y'all have heard that? That the church is just this filler type thing until Jesus comes again to set up his kingdom because he couldn't quite get the job done the first time. I want to tell you something right now. If Jesus Christ came to this earth in the first century and he could not do what he came here to do, he can't be my Savior. If God was not powerful enough when he came here in the flesh to accomplish what he set out to accomplish and to do what he planned to do, and somehow man caught up with him and crucified him before he could accomplish what he came to accomplish, he can't be my God because he ain't powerful enough. He's not as powerful as man is. I want us to notice from Ephesians chapter 3 that the church has always been in the plan of God. The church was in the plan of God before God even began the foundations of the earth. In Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 4, it talks about this eternal plan, but he goes into it more in detail in Ephesians 3, beginning at verse 8, where the Apostle Paul writes to the first century church of Christ in Ephesus. He says, "To me, who am less than the least of all the saints, this grace was given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the ages has been hidden in God, who created all things through Jesus Christ, to the intent," the whole intent of this, "was that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and powers in the heavenly places, according to the eternal purpose which he accomplished in Christ Jesus." The existence of the church proves the manifold wisdom of God in this eternal plan. God's plan before he ever made the heavens and the earth was that he knew once he made mankind, mankind was going to mess up in sin. He knew that eventually he was going to send his son to die for us. This was the plan in place before the foundation of the world. Tells us that again in Titus. And he was going to have to send his son to die for us, and that those who are saved by his blood would constitute the church. This has always been the plan of God. The church was not a stopgap. The existence of the church is the pinnacle, the final touch on this eternal purpose which he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord, when he put us in Christ Jesus our Lord, when we repented and were baptized and came to be his church. This has always been the plan. And the reason I bring that up is because the church has always been in the plan of God. So when we read back in the Old Testament and we see this kingdom that's always been in the plan of God, we can see that the kingdom and the church, again, are both the same thing. This was always the plan. And I just want to throw something out here before we move to our second group. Listen closely. There are those in the religious world who claim today that the Lord is going to come back and establish his kingdom, despite all we've covered, and we've seen the kingdom's already been around since the day of Pentecost, 33 AD, but they claim that the kingdom's not here yet, the kingdom is yet to come, and they claim that at some point in time, Jesus is going to come back, rapture some souls to heaven, 3.5 years good, 3.5 years bad, all of this stuff. They built this whole doctrine you can't find in the Bible anywhere, and then they claim that Jesus is going to come back and reign for 1,000 years on a literal throne in Jerusalem. Brethren, if that is true, your Bible is a lie. Because the Bible is very clear that Jesus cannot possibly ever rule on a literal throne in Jerusalem. The scripture is clear. Turn with me in your Bibles to Jeremiah chapter 22. It is ridiculously anti-biblical to say that Jesus can reign on a literal physical throne in Jerusalem, because he can't. Not have the Bible be true. In Jeremiah chapter 22... notice with me, please, Jeremiah 22 and verse 18. One of the Old Testament kings, God's had enough. It says, "Therefore, thus says the Lord concerning Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah. Keep in mind that this Jehoiakim, as God speaks concerning him, is also called Kaniah. You know, sometimes you have like Peter, Cephas, same guy, right? Saul, Paul, same guy, okay? In the scriptures, this Jehoiakim of verse 18 is the same one that is called Kaniah in verse 24. The New King James actually has that in a footnote where it says Kaniah means Jeconiah or Jehoiakim. But anyway, verse 24, watch this. As I live, says the Lord, though Kaniah, the son of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, were the signet on my right hand, yet I would pluck you off, and I would give you into the hand of those who seek your life, and into the hand of those whose face you fear, the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and the hand of the Chaldeans. Watch this. So I will cast you out and your mother who bore you into another country where you were not born, and there you shall die. But to the land to which they desire to return, they shall not return. Is this man Kaniah, a despised broken idol, a vessel in which is no pleasure? Why they are cast out, he and his descendants, and cast into a land which they do not know? O earth, 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 hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord, write this man down as childless, a man who shall not prosper in his days, for none of his descendants shall prosper, sitting on the throne of David and ruling anymore in Judah. God says, mark this down, get it right, understand it, you better get this. This man, none of his descendants shall prosper sitting on the throne of David and ruling anymore in Judah. God says, ain't gonna happen. None of his descendants are ever gonna reign from that throne. Guess what? In Matthew chapter 1, verse 11, in the genealogy of Jesus Christ, this man is mentioned. Jesus is a descendant of this man. Jesus, therefore, can never reign from an earthly throne, the throne of David, period. Because if he does, that verse is contradicted. And then, number two, I want to tell you another group that denies that the kingdom is come. Y'all seen these before, right? I think we got this out of the door one day when we got home. I don't remember where I got it, but I thought, boy, I got to keep that for that Sunday night lesson. The Watchtower magazine, and they have some interesting stuff on the back here, and all of it's incorrect, pretty much, but it's interesting, nonetheless, for the purposes of this study. Listen to what it says on the back of this, and again, please understand, I'm not teaching this stuff, I want you to know what it says, even though it's incorrect. On the back of this, they say, what is the kingdom of God? Some people believe that it represents the reign of God in a person's heart. Others think that it is the product of human efforts to bring world peace and brotherhood. What do you think? Newsflash. Doesn't matter what we think. Doesn't matter what they think. The only thing that matters is what the Word of God says. When somebody starts a conversation with you, hey, what do you really believe? Well, you don't really believe. Automatic response needs to be, doesn't matter what I believe. What does the Word of God say? So they set you up wrong to begin with. And then the second section of these six says, this is what the Bible says. The God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed. It will crush and put an end to all these kingdoms. Daniel 2:44. That's true, but what they don't tell you is that in that very same verse, it explains in the days of those kings, the Roman empires, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom. They conveniently leave out the time frame. What the third section says. What else we learn from the Bible? God uses the kingdom to accomplish his will in heaven and on earth, Matthew 6:10. You'll remember we covered that this morning. In Matthew chapter 6 and verse 10, Jesus was teaching his disciples to pray, and he said, pray thus, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Remember, they're saying that the kingdom hasn't come yet, that God will use the kingdom to accomplish his will. But as we covered this morning, that was before Acts 2. That was before the kingdom came. Those disciples then should have been praying for the kingdom to come, because it hadn't yet. And they should understand that when the kingdom came, it would be a place where God's people would obey God the same way as the beings in heaven obey God. But they don't tell you that either. The fourth section on back. Multiple choice. Here's a quiz for you. When will God's kingdom come? What would you say? Choice number one, no one knows. Choice number two, soon. Choice number three, never. Hello?
Yep.
They conveniently left out the one where it's already come. And then they say this, what the Bible says. Now they're going to tell you what the Bible says, supposedly. They're going to quote Matthew 24:14. This good news of the kingdom will be preached in all the inhabited earth for a witness to all nations, and then the end will come. Once the good news has been fully preached, the kingdom will come to bring the present wicked system to an end. I have heard from denominational types that this is kind of the idea that a lot of them as well send out missionaries, because as soon as the gospel is preached in all the nations, then the end will come, the Lord will come back, set up his kingdom. Matthew 24:14. Here's the problem with that. All of that reasoning completely leaves out the context of those very comments in Matthew 24. Please turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 24. In Matthew chapter 24, Jesus, at the beginning of this chapter, is asked three questions, which he goes on then to answer, and sort of apply to one another over the next two chapters. He's asked three questions. Matthew 24:1. One of the most misquoted, maligned, abused, tortured, perverted passages in all of Scripture is Matthew 24. People will take Matthew 24 and they'll try to tie it to the end of days. They'll take the first part of Matthew 24 and try to tie it to this kingdom not yet established. All kinds of weird, contorted loops and hoops. Let's look at the three questions. Jesus went out and departed from the temple, Matthew 24:1, and his disciples came up to show him the buildings of the temple. Jesus said to them, "Do you see these things? Assuredly I say to you, not one stone shall be left here upon another that shall not be thrown down." Jesus is talking about the temple, which was destroyed in 70 AD. Now, as he sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately, saying, "Tell us, when will these things be? When are these stones going to be torn down one from another? When's that going to happen?" Now, if they stopped right there and Jesus answered that question, Matthew 24 would not be complicated at all, but they don't stop there. They ask two more. Do you ever have your kids ask you a question and before you could answer, they ask you three more questions? That's kind of what's going on. "Tell us, when will these things be? And what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age?" All of a sudden, Jesus got three questions to answer. And so he goes on to answer all three questions. Here's what I want you to understand. You can interpret these verses any way you want to and some of the stuff that's said, but the one thing you must understand is that everything prior to verse 34 is in answer to the first question. Let me say that again. Everything prior to verse 34 is in answer to the first question, no matter how you can slice it, dice it, cut it sideways, and put a pretty pattern on it. Everything prior to verse 34 is in answer to the first question. How do we know that? Look at verse 34. After Jesus concludes what he goes on to teach from verses 5 through 33, he says, "Assuredly, I say to you, this generation will by no means pass away till all these things take place." Boom. It's that simple. Boom. Everything I've told you to this point, Jesus says, is going to happen before this generation passes away, talking to those people then. Now, then he goes on to say, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will by no means pass away. But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only." Follow this carefully, very carefully. Up until verse 34, Jesus has given them plenty of signs in answer to his first question about when those stones are going to be torn down. He said, "This is how you're going to know. You're going to see the abomination of desolation. It's going to be wars, rumors of wars. It's going to be this, going to be that, going to be something else." He spends 30 verses telling them all the different signs to watch out for before those stones are torn down one from another. And he says in verse 34, that's all going to happen during this generation. Then he moves on to another subject in verse 35. When he says, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words shall no means pass away, but of that day and hour," what day and hour? The day and hour that the heavens and the earth pass away. "Of that day and hour, nobody knows." You see the difference? He said if this first thing happened, there's all kinds of signs. You ought to be able to figure this one out when it happens. But of the heavens and the earth passing away, nobody knows when that's going to happen. Now, number six. The first part says, no one on earth knows exactly when God's kingdom will come, according to the JWs. No one knows exactly when God's kingdom will come, and they quote, as a reference, Matthew 24, 36. Folks, Matthew 24, 36 isn't talking about the kingdom at all. It's talking about when heaven and earth pass away. That's the context. Do you see it? It's not talking about the kingdom at all. Let me ask you a question. When Paul said to the Colossians in Colossians 1, 13, that God has transferred us out of the domain of darkness and conferred us into the kingdom of the Son that he loves, did Paul know when the kingdom came? Sure he did. He knew they were in it. He knew that it had already come. When John in Revelation chapter 1 and verse 9 said, I, John, your brother and fellow partaker in the tribulation and the kingdom, did he understand the kingdom had already come? Sure he did. He knew that. So don't stand here with some man-made paper and tell me that no one on earth knows exactly when God's kingdom will come. Every passage regarding the kingdom prior to Acts 2 when the church was established looks forward in the future. Every passage on the spiritual kingdom having been established or talking about it looks back to it as something that already happened after you get past Acts 2. Do we know when the kingdom came? Yes, we do. Acts chapter 2, when the Lord's church was established on the day of Pentecost. Yep, we know. And then it says, finally, but Bible prophecy shows that the kingdom will come soon. Really? But here's what they quote. Listen. They quote Matthew 24, verse 3, Matthew 24, verse 7, and Matthew 24, verse 12. Bible prophecy shows the kingdom will come soon. And then they use three verses that are all talking about the destruction of the temple in the first century. Pull them completely out of context. Listen. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out that Jesus, in Matthew chapter 24, all the way up through verse 34, is talking about the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. Let's look at some of this. He says in verse 4, take heed that no one deceives you. Many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and will deceive many. And you'll hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. How many of you have heard that by some religious person applied to a future kingdom in the end of the world? Not what it applies to. Verse 34 said everything I talked about prior to verse 34 is going to happen in this generation. Nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There'll be famines, pestilences, and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Then they will deliver you up to tribulation and kill you. You'll be hated by all nations for my name's sake. Many will be offended and betray one another and will hate one another. Many false prophets will rise up and deceive many, and because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold, but he who endures to the end shall be saved. Then look at this next verse. This is the one they quoted. This is why they say, we've got to go into all the nations and preach the gospel, because then the end will come. Look what he says in verse 14. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations, and then the end will come. Brethren, he ain't talking about the end of the world. He's talking about the end of Judaism as God's chosen people. How do we know that? Because in your Bible, right in front of you, there is a passage where the Apostle Paul says, middle of the first century, that the word has been preached into all the world. It's happened. Turn your Bibles to Colossians chapter 1 and verse 23, and you will find it. Jesus said in Matthew 24, once this gospel is preached in all the world, then the end is going to come. Not talking about the end of the world. In the latter part of the middle first century, Paul would write to the church of Christ in Colossae the following words in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 23. And as soon as I get there, I'll be glad to read it. Colossians 1 and verse 23. Paul has talked about them. He says, if indeed you continue in the faith, grounded and steadfast, and are not moved away from the hope of the gospel, which you heard, which was preached, past tense, to every creature under heaven. Your translation may say to every nation or to in all the world. The bottom line is this. Those who want to say that we've got to preach in every... Now, it's a great thing to evangelize the world. We're supposed to be doing that. But to say that as soon as we get the gospel into all nations, that the end of the world is coming and this kingdom is going to be established is ridiculous. Because in the middle first century, Paul said this gospel has gone into all the world. That was written around 60-61 AD. And within a decade, guess what happened? Every stone was ripped down on one from another as the temple was destroyed. That was exactly what Jesus was talking about. He wasn't talking about the end of the world and some thousand-year reign. That actually already happened. How do we know for sure? Well, go back with me to Matthew 24. He said what he did in verse 14, and he says, therefore, verse 15, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, whoever reads, let him understand. People have taken that verse and connected it. Oh, when the temple's rebuilt in Jerusalem, or this has happened, or that's happened, or this abomination of desolation. Folks, Luke makes it real simple in his gospel. In Luke 21, in verse 20, he simply says, when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, that's the abomination of desolation. When you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, when was Jerusalem surrounded by armies? In 70 AD, when the temple was destroyed and the stones were torn down one from another. That's what Jesus is talking about, happened within their generation. He's not talking about the end of the world there. Because look what he says. Back in Matthew 24, 15, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Okay, let's talk about this reasonably. Let's have a little reasonable Bible study. If this is talking about the end of days, I mean the end when the Lord comes and the mountains and the heavens and the earth are burned up with a flame of fire, if he's talking about that coming, what good is it going to do you to flee to the mountains? Can you escape by fleeing to the mountains when that day comes? No, of course not. It's not what he's talking about. Look at the rest of it. And let him who is in the field not go back to get his clothes, but woe to those who are pregnant, to those who are nursing babies in those days. What has that got to do with the end, the total end of days? Let me ask you a question. If a Christian woman is pregnant when the Lord comes back and it's the end of everything, can she still go to heaven? He says, boy, pray you aren't pregnant and nursing in those days, and pray that your flight may not be in winter or on a Sabbath. He's not talking about the end of the world, folks. He's telling the inhabitants of Jerusalem, look, when you see the Roman armies come to tear down this temple stone upon stone, the end of the Jewish people is God's people. You better hope that none of the ladies are pregnant because you're going to have to flee to the mountains. It's hard for a pregnant lady to run. Not only that, but he says, pray that your flight may not be in winter. You better hope it's not cold and you've got little ones and you're struggling to get out of Jerusalem, out of those walls when the Romans come in to just lay it waste. He says, pray that your flight is not on a Sabbath. Pray it doesn't happen on a Sabbath. Is it going to make any difference if it's a Saturday or Tuesday when the Lord comes back? Is that going to matter?
Yeah.
Not that much. Why do you say it? Because he's talking about the destruction of Jerusalem. Because if it's a Sabbath day, guess what? The gates to Jerusalem are closed. And devout Jews couldn't go more than a Sabbath day's journey. So he says, when those Roman armies come, you better make sure, hope, pray that all of these things are not the case. And he goes on to describe it from there in the ensuing verses. But however you want to translate any of the rest, it talks about the Lord coming. Folks, the Lord has come many times in judgment of nations. You can go back and read Isaiah 13. The Lord came in judgment of Babylon. He would come in 70 AD in judgment of the Jews. In a spiritual sense, he's come in judgment to many nations over time. But that's not the final coming. And you can't take these verses that are to be applied to this and transpose them into some kingdom and some... Let's take the Bible in context. You know how much confusion we'd clear up if we did that? Thirdly. Did you say I was fiery? What's that all about? Anyway. I was going to argue with him when I first got up here, and I thought, if I get into God's word, it's probably going to happen. So anyway. Thirdly, and perhaps most tragically of all, going to the final group that denies the kingdom, the church, for what God described it as, sadly, and this breaks my heart, really does, there are those within the very Lord's church itself, whom the Apostle Peter described very well in 2 Peter 2 and 3, who neither understand, appreciate, admit, or advocate the truth about the Lord's one, exclusive, priceless, precious, unique, blood-bought, pre-denominational, undivided, undenominated, unrivaled kingdom of God or church of Christ, which has been in the plan of God since before time began. There are those, sadly, within the church who militantly advocate against her. Many years ago, I had the opportunity to go to a gospel meeting lectureship style meeting south of Boston, Massachusetts in Taunton. And went to that, and in the bookstore there, I was going down through these books. The Bible bookstore had some stuff there, and I went down through this, and it said the origin of denominations and where they were founded. And I picked it up and looked at it, and it made me seethe with anger. It said, the Church of Christ was founded in 1801 by Barton W. Stone in Cane Ridge, Kentucky. I must tell you that there are those in the Lord's church today who want the Lord's church, the Lord's kingdom that was prophesied in the Old Testament, the one that Jesus died to purchase with his blood, Acts 20, verse 28, the one that Peter opened up the door to on the day of Pentecost, Matthew 16 and Acts 2. They want to take that beautiful, blood-bought church of our God and Savior that we read about in places like the New Testament and we see referred to in Romans 16, 16. They want to take that church and they want to put it on the level of man-made churches. That ought to make every one of us fired up. That ought to make each one of us very, very intense. Listen, I can't help but say this. You have one of the greatest blessings in this congregation, besides Landon. You have a lot of young people, proportionately speaking to the total number. I am begging you tonight, be very wary about where you send them, where you let them attend, and the things they listen to. Not everything that says Church of Christ is Church of Christ. If you want to totally destroy everything that you have sought to set up with their understanding of the Lord's church as this precious, beautiful, blood-bought kingdom in the plan of God before time began, if you want to completely destroy that and rip it apart, I got a list of so-called Christian colleges you can send them to, because we got some professors in some of our Church of Christ associated colleges who want to convince your kids that the Lord's church is nothing more than a modern-day man-made denomination started by Barton W. Stone in 1801 in Cane Ridge, Kentucky, or by Alexander Campbell around that same time. We have this thing in our brotherhood called Winterfest. All of the men who are in leading positions in that are okay with instrumental music, female preachers, and letting everybody know that this Church of Christ is no different than the Baptist Church or the Presbyterian Church or any other man-made church. Be very careful where you send your young people. Listen, there are those that want to claim Barton W. Stone established the Church of Christ. Well, he's really old, because like when the Book of Romans was written, it was in there, you know, 2,000 years ago. But listen to this and consider this. Barton W. Stone, Alexander Campbell, and the rest of their contemporaries in the 1800s did not establish the Church of Christ any more than Josiah established Judaism. What, remember the story of Josiah? Remember God's people had gotten all off track and they had diluted all of their beliefs and they had just become this man-made religion-loving group. You remember that? In Josiah, they found the book of the law and they brought it to King Josiah, and Josiah read it and basically said, "Wow, we got to get back to doing things the way the book says to do it." You remember that story? In case you don't, it's in, where is it? There it is. It's in 2 Kings chapters 22 and 23. And Josiah said, "We've got to get back." And so Josiah has the book read, and he says, "Okay, we've got to do it this way, and we've got to do it this way. We've got to get back to the book. We've got to do it God's way." Did Josiah establish Judaism? No. What he did was, he simply went back to the book and said, "Let's do religion the way God said." Alexander Campbell is no different. Martin W. Stone is no different. You and I better be no different. What is our job? To take people back to the book and say, "Hey, let's do this God's way." You didn't establish the Church of Christ in Ramona, but you best be making sure they're on track. Same way with me in Cleveland. We didn't establish the church. We're just saying, "Hey, let's do this God's way." And those people who want to turn the Church of Christ into some man-made religious group are not to be supported and cuddled and coddled. They are to be exposed and marked and avoided at all cost. Say, "Doug, well, that's pretty unfair." No, that's pretty biblical. Open your Bibles to Romans 16 for a moment, would you please? Pretty biblical. Paul says in Romans 16 and verse 16, "Greet one another with a holy kiss. The churches of Christ greet you." Then look what he says. We often forget this. He says, "Now I urge you, brethren, note those who cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you have learned, and avoid them. For those who are such do not serve our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by smooth words and flattering speech they deceive the hearts of the simple." He says that anybody who causes divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which they had already learned by about 60 AD, anybody that's teaching something that came beyond that, he said, you mark and avoid them. You don't have anything to do with them. We could read a lot of passages. We could read Ephesians 5:11, where it talks about exposing these evil deeds of darkness. We could read Galatians 1:6-10. Where Paul says, even if we or an angel from heaven preach unto you a different gospel than the one you've already heard, let him be accursed. Again, I'm going to tell you again, and he does. If anybody comes along preaching a different gospel than what those first century Christians heard, they're not preaching the gospel of Christ. They're perverting the gospel of Christ. 2 Peter 3, 14-18. Perhaps two of the best epistles on the power and the purpose and the preeminence and the pricelessness of the first century kingdom and church that Christ established, that church of God which he purchased with his own blood, are the epistles to the first century congregations of the churches of Christ in Ephesians 1 and Colossians 1. If you get a chance tonight, tomorrow morning, go home and read Ephesians 1:15 and following and Colossians 1:13 and following. There's one church. Christ is the head of it. He has preeminence, and we follow him. And anybody that teaches anything different than what this Bible teaches and what they were taught back then ain't following Christ. I said as I closed the sermon this morning, and this was on the outline, kind of wraps up today. Any church not originally established during the reign of the Roman Empire, Daniel 2:44, and within the then living disciples' lifetime, Mark 9:1, in Jerusalem, Isaiah 2:3, by Peter, Matthew 16:18 and 19, honoring and teaching repentance and baptism for the forgiveness of sins as the terms of entrance into that church or kingdom, Acts 2:37 through 47, is not Christ's church. That is not God's kingdom, according to Scripture. Nor would I add, is any church that does not continue steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and no one else's ever. Brethren, we often stop at Acts 2:38 or Acts 2:41 Acts 2:42 tells us what the church, the kingdom, went on to do from there. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. Nobody else's. Not Doug's, not Landon's, not Billy Graham's, not the Pope's. Nobody else's, not Martin Luther's. The apostles' doctrine. The day we stop abiding in the apostles' doctrine is the day we stop being the Church of Christ. Speaking of churches and where they were established, the Lord's was established in Jerusalem when Peter opened it up. What about during the reign of the Roman Empire? What about the Roman Catholic Church that was established by Constantine in Rome about 250 years after the Apostle Peter's death? Would that fit the pattern of the Lord's Church? No. No, it wouldn't, not at all. What about in 1517 to 1546, the Lutheran Church was established by Martin Luther and his followers in Germany? Where was the Lord's Church to start? Jerusalem. Luther's Church started in Germany. Can Luther's Church then be the Lord's Church? No. The Lord's Church would start when Peter opened it up on the day of Pentecost during the reign of the Roman Empire between 190 BC and 395 AD. Can a church which Luther started 1,200 years after, 1,100 years after the Roman Empire went down in flames, can that be the Lord's Church? No, not according to the Scripture. What about in 1534 when the Church of England or the Episcopal Church was established by King Henry VIII in England? Can that be the Lord's Church? Doesn't fit the pattern. What about 1550 when the Congregational Church was established by Robert Brown in England? Where in the Bible does it say that when this kingdom was established, the word would go forth from England? Where does it say that this man would, this Robert Brown, where does it say that Robert Brown would have the keys to opening up the Lord's Church? Doesn't say that, does it? That's not even possible. What about the Baptist Church that was established in Holland by John Smith in 1607? Was that during the reign of the Roman Empire? No. What about the Methodist Church in 1739, established by John Wesley? No, none of those are the church established when Peter opened it up on the day of Pentecost during the reign of the Roman Empire. Listen. In the last 200 years, modern-day contemporary cults and religious groups such as the Mormons, by the way, all of these are less than 200 years old, the Mormons, the Seventh-day Adventists, the Christian Scientists, Jehovah's Witnesses, the Church of the Nazarene, the Church of God, the Assembly of God, First Christian Church, and the Pentecostals have all come about in the last 200 years. Were any of them established under the Roman Empire? Can they be the Lord's Church? It's amazing to me when we ride over through. Karen and I go to Claremore every Tuesday over to Hope Harbor. It's amazing to me when I look at the names of all the churches between Cleveland and Claremore. Some of the most ridiculous names. Everybody's got to have a new name on their church. What's this Guts Church thing? I'm sorry, but what's that all about? Can you imagine how the Lord must just be insulted after all he did to establish his church, to have a church named God? I'm not trying to pick on the people, but folks, the doctrine's wrong. But we have those folks that will say, well, you know what? We're just all part of the same. Have you ever heard that? We're all part of the same church. Doesn't matter what denomination, we're all just part of the one church of Christ. You ever heard that? How many have heard that besides me? If you folks are really shy, you've never heard anything. Okay. I want to share something with you before we close. After the afternoon I had, I'm talking about food again. Really? Okay. The original fast food restaurant was McDonald's. McDonald's was the original fast food burger joint. It started, listen closely, it started in 1937 on Route 66 in Monrovia, California, by a man named Patrick McDonald. His two sons later relocated it, changed the menu, and the rest is history. Today, their corporate headquarters is located in Oak Brook, Illinois. Remember that. Started in 1937, California, Patrick McDonald. Their headquarters is in Oak Brook, Illinois. Okay? Based on the immense success of the McDonald's Brothers restaurant concept, which had begun in earnest in California by 1948, 5 years later, in 1953, in Jacksonville, Florida, Keith Kramer and Matthew Burns founded a fledgling new copycat company hoping to mimic the McDonald's Brothers' success, and their new restaurant eventually became Burger King. Their corporate headquarters today is located in Miami-Dade County, Florida. Number three, Carl's Jr., on the other hand, was started by a man named Carl Karcher in 1941 when he and his wife, Margaret, borrowed $311 using their car as collateral to purchase a hot dog cart. Within 5 years, they opened, owned, and operated a restaurant named Carl's Drive-In Barbecue in Anaheim, California, and later opened a couple of smaller Carl's Jr. restaurants. Today, their corporate headquarters is in Carpinteria, California. And finally, lest we forget, Oklahoma's very own Sonic Drive-In was started by a man named Troy Smith from Seminole, Oklahoma in the mid-1950s. The original Sonic sign can still be seen at their location in Stillwater, and their corporate headquarters is still located in Oklahoma City. Here's the point. If I were to stand before you today, now keep in mind, Sonic, you cannot go inside Sonic and eat. You have to order and they bring it out, okay? McDonald's has both a drive-through and you can go inside and eat. Burger King does the same thing. All of these employees of these different corporations, they have different ways they make the burgers, they have different ways they make the food, they have different logos on their uniforms, they get their paychecks from different corporate headquarters. Each one of them has corporate headquarters in a different place. Imagine if I walked in here and said to you, hey Landon, did you know that Sonic and Burger King are all part of the McDonald's Corporation? Exactly. I wish you could see him giggle. If I walked in here and said, Sonic, Burger King, and Carl's Jr., even though they have different headquarters, they were started in different times, in different places, by different men with different agendas, in different years, but they're all part of McDonald's, you'd never let me come over here and preach again, because you'd think I was out of my mind, quite frankly. I know I'm from Maine, you'd think I was a real maniac, right? Brethren, it is no more absurd to say that all those different restaurants are all part of the original restaurant, even though they're all different. They have different logos. They have different headquarters. They have different people that started them in different times. It is no more insane to say they're all part of McDonald's than to say that all of these different churches started in all of these different places, Germany, England, etc., all started in different years, 1607, 1530, 1536, by different men, King Henry VIII or Joseph Smith or whomever. Say, well, they're all just part of the Church of Christ. You see the two statements? They're the same thing. The fact is that God knew in his wisdom, he knew that there, once his church came into existence, his beautiful, precious kingdom, that Jesus shed his blood on that cross to establish, and that Peter opened up on the day of Pentecost in Jerusalem during the days of the Roman Empire when he put forth the terms of entrance, repentance, and baptism, which heaven now honors. God knew. God knew that within a few years, or few centuries, there would be counterfeits, copycats, cheap man-made knockoffs and look-alikes, that just like the guys that started Burger King seeking to mimic the success of the original McDonald's, that these copycats would come along seeking to mimic the success of the original church while feeding off of people's spiritual hunger. God wrote about it. As we close tonight, I want to share those verses with you where God wrote about it. 2 Peter chapter 2. Please turn there. God knew. God always does. In 2 Peter chapter 2, he says this. Verse 1. But there were also false prophets among the people, even as there will be false prophets among you, who will secretly bring in destructive heresies. The King James Version says damnable heresies, even denying the Lord who bought them. Folks, when people insist on any doctrine that is different from what the Lord God Almighty insisted on in His Word, they are denying the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ. He says they will come denying the Lord who brought them and bring on themselves swift destruction, and many will follow their destructive ways, because of whom the way of truth will be blasphemed. By covetousness they will exploit you with deceptive. By covetousness they will exploit you with deceptive words. What does that mean? One version says in their greed they will exploit you. Folks, if something is successful, there are going to be those copycats that come along and seek to take advantage for monetary gain. He said that's what the purpose is. I guarantee you that if America made a new law that no preacher ever gets paid again for his preaching services, that 95% of the denominations would fall by the wayside. See those denominations go, that's the price I'd be willing to pay and go back to driving a truck and preaching on Sundays. But God tells you why they're doing it. He tells you why they're coming up with these deceptive words. He tells you why the way of truth will be blasphemed. It's all about the money. Follow the money. God tells you that right there. That's the reason. But back in verse 19 of chapter 1, Peter had said, "We have the prophetic word confirmed, which you would do well to heed, as a light that shines in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts, knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation. For prophecy never came by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit." Brethren, this Bible right here is what the English Standard Version in Psalm 119 verse 89 says is forever firmly fixed in the heavens. This isn't going to change. This is the plan. This is the pattern. This tells us about the kingdom, the church that the Lord wants us in. A lot of churches out there, a lot of man-made teachings you can't find in the Scriptures. And this is not a will. We're right and they're right. That's not what this is about. I want to go to heaven. How many want to go to heaven? Raise your hands. Want to go to heaven? You know the only way we're going to get to heaven? By trusting the Lord enough to do it the way the Lord said. You know the only way our friends and neighbors are going to get to heaven? By trusting the Lord enough to do it the way the Lord said. And if they don't understand that, then it is up to us to help them see what the Bible actually says about the kingdom, the church, and the fact that they need to be in it. We got to follow that plan. If there's anybody here tonight who's not followed that plan, maybe you've heard the gospel and you believe that Jesus is the Christ, but you've never repented. You've never said, "You know what? I'm going to turn my heart to God, and from now on I'm going to live with Him as Lord." Maybe you've never done that. Maybe you've not confessed His name. Maybe you've not been willing to stand up and let people know that you're a Christian, a member of the Lord's church. You know, sometimes when you let people know that you're a member of the Lord's church, they go, "Oh, that bunch." You ever heard that? Them? Proud of it. You know why I'm proud of it? Because if the Church of Christ was good enough for the apostles of the Lord, it's good enough for me. If it was good enough for them to get to heaven, and it was good enough for the Lord to die for and shed His blood for, you know what? It's more than good enough for me. Maybe you've never been baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. Being baptized isn't enough. A person can be baptized all day long, but if they don't repent or if it's not for the right reasons, doesn't do you any good. You've got to be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins, for that express and specific purpose. And once that is done, you need to live faithful unto death. Revelation 2:10. That doesn't mean perfect. None of us are perfect. Everybody in this room needs the grace of God. The guy standing in front of you needs it as much as any of you do. I'm not perfect, but thank God I'm forgiven by the blood of Christ. But I'm going to live every day that I can being as faithful to that word as I know how to be, and try to learn how to be more faithful every day that goes by. That's what it takes to be a disciple. If you failed in any of those areas, any way that we, the church, can help, we would be delighted this night, this Lord's night. Would you please join us down front if you have a need as we stand and as we sing?
Three.